Hi guys, I'm Cassie.
And I'm Eric.
And we're Keto for Carboholics.
And in this video, we're gonna be teaching you in 4 easy steps how to get started on a ketogenic diet today.
Step 1.
Measurements and macros.
You want to start by taking your measurements. When we're talking about taking your measurements, we're talking about measuring your body all around. We're going to actually link some websites below that you're going to go to calculate your body fat percentage. And to do that, you need accurate body measurements. So not only is that going to help you when we're calculating your macros, but it's also going to help you by letting you know where you're actually starting. Many of us have no idea where we're starting. When I first started, before I lost 60 pounds, I was at size 16, 18 in pants. But I was really pushing it. Those pants should have been more like an 18-20. They were busting at the seams. So when I started to lose weight, I didn't necessarily go down a pant size, and it was kind of discouraging because I was thinking, the pounds are coming off, why aren't my pants fitting better? Well, they were fitting better, but now they were actually fitting me as someone in that size should be fitting in those pants. So by knowing what my inches were when I started off, I could go back and say, okay, I'm not moving sizes yet, but I have lost inches in my waist. Also, we don't always just lose weight in our waist. Sometimes it comes off of our thighs, our calves, our arms, our neck, places that we don't think about generally. And so unless we're tracking and know where we're starting, we wouldn't be able to monitor that progress. And sometimes seeing the inches come off is very motivating in keeping you going with the diet or your lifestyle.
Sometimes taking a picture at each stage of weight loss can also be helpful. It gives you a visual representation of where you started, if you've met any of your goals, and maybe what your final goal will be based on meeting each small step goal.
I know transformation pictures have been one of the biggest motivators for me. Not only myself, but looking at other people who have had a big transformation, I think it motivates people, well, if that person can do it, I can do it too.
I agree.
Make sure to take accurate body measurements, but also take a picture so you can look back on as well and monitor your progress. Now that we know what our measurements are, we need to figure out what our body fat percentage is. So again, we've linked it below. It'll be the first website for body fat calculation. You'll input your measurements in there along with your weight and your height, and that way you can get an accurate body fat percentage that you can then input into the next calculator, the macros calculator.
Pro tip on the body fat calculator, nobody is 100% or 0% body fat. If you're getting either of those results, make sure that you've entered your information correctly. Most body fat calculators give you the option of doing feet and inches, depending on how you like to measure yourself and report that information. I recommend most people just put 0 for feet and put everything in inches. Use one uniform measurement system and you'll get good results.
Also make sure that you're selecting the correct gender. It automatically starts off at male, so it's a big difference if you're putting your information in as a female and you select male. After you've got that information, you've calculated your body fat percentage, you wanna head over to a website to calculate your macros. Our favorite website is Rule.com. Me. We're not affiliated with them in any way, but we really find that their macro calculator is very accurate. So you input your body fat percentage, you input all of your other metrics that it's going to ask for, and be honest, because lying is not going to help you on your weight loss journey.
The only person you're cheating is yourself, and you want to make sure that it's reporting the accurate amount of protein that you should be having as well as calories based on things like your activity level, body fat percentage, age, gender, weight. And if you're dishonest with any of those, then you may get the wrong macronutrient breakdown, and you may not have as much success in implementing this diet correctly.
And you might be thinking, what the hell's a macro? I have no idea. That's the second part of this first step, and it's macros. And that's the breakdown of your caloric need. The website is going to tell you what you need for calories, and think of that as the umbrella. And then underneath that is going to be the breakdown of those calories, your fats, your net carbs, and your proteins.
Step 2, eating whole foods within your macros.
This is probably one of the most important steps because this is where you get all of your macro micronutrients from.
Try to stay away from processed foods such as keto branded foods that are prepackaged and sold right off the shelf. Many of these foods may meet the criteria of a ketogenic diet, but these highly processed foods may contain other things that are not going to be beneficial from a micronutrient standpoint.
Some of them even have sugar, dextrose, or other sweeteners that just aren't great on a ketogenic diet because it causes blood glucose spikes.
So stick with real, whole, unprocessed foods, green leafy vegetables, healthy meats, berries, nuts, and other sources of healthy fats.
So now that you've gotten your macros off of a calculator like Rule.me, you know that that is the parameter that you need to live within. You know what your calories are for the day, and you know what the breakdown is for fats, proteins, and carbs. Now, what do you eat to fill that in? This is my biggest tip for everyone that wants to start keto, and they have no idea how to make their food work within their day. I say start every day by tracking your food in advance. you can't uneat food once you've eaten them, and you don't want to blow your whole day on one meal. So I like to track the night before, and I'm someone that always needs a dessert. It's how I've stayed keto for over 2 years. It's because I have something to look forward to at the end of the day. So I track my dessert first, then I track my breakfast and my dinner. Whatever is left for macros, I make a salad out of because I want to get some leafy greens in during the day, and it really does fill me up. It starts off as a base salad, it's super low calorie too. So my spinach and my lettuce. Then I add on to it based on what I have available for macros. If I need more fat, I'll add avocado, dressing, oil, cheese. If you need more protein, you can add eggs, you can add meat, you can add higher protein vegetables. You would adjust your salad to meet your needs. And that's how I fill it in. That's how I make sure that I still hit my fats, that I get my protein. I'm not going over. Sometimes people try to do two high protein meals, one for lunch and one for dinner, and they find that they're not able to hit their fats and they're going really far over on protein.
Tracking can also be beneficial if you're somebody like me who doesn't have much of an off switch when it comes to actually filling up your stomach. When you track, you keep yourself accountable because you're pre-tracking and you make sure you're actually eating what you're putting in your nutrition tracker. If you overeat, you know by how much and how to retrain for the next day not to do that. Like Cassie said, plan your dessert first. If you're somebody who insists on having dessert, plan your breakfast because it's the first thing you're gonna wake up and eat and you wanna already be prepared for what you're gonna eat. And then fill the rest of your macro and micronutrients with your lunch. It's a great way to keep yourself on target and not go over, even if you're somebody who likes to overindulge like myself.
When it comes down to it, while calories in, calories out aren't the most important thing when we're talking about a diet, they do play a role. And if you have a calorie surplus, you're not going to lose weight. So making sure you're staying within your caloric deficit is going to be beneficial in losing weight. I've heard too often on the ketogenic diet that people say they're not losing weight or they stall. And oftentimes it's they're overeating protein and they're overeating calories. If you have that surplus, you're not going to lose weight. Step 3, water and electrolytes.
The ketogenic diet is a naturally diuretic diet. What this means is it sensitizes your kidney to the excretion of sodium, which pulls water out with it. With that in mind, you have to take into account the fact that you're losing sodium and may need to supplement this, particularly within the first couple of weeks of being on this type of diet.
I really like to sip on broth, whether it's bone broth or regular broth, and it helps to get in some sodium. It also helps if you're, you know, just a little peckish, maybe just want a snack. It's super low calorie, it has a tiny bit of protein in it if you're just going for regular broth, or more protein if you're going for bone broth. If you need to get a little more fat in, I like to actually put a tablespoon of butter into it and blend it with a little garlic powder and chili flakes. It's super delicious.
Some people might even add a little MCT oil if they're really trying to boost their ketone production and get really the right types of fats in, but that's not necessary unless you're trying to get those calories in as well.
We had said that you want to be replenishing both water and electrolytes.
That's
right.
Sodium
is one of those electrolytes. The other ones are going to be magnesium and potassium. Those are the other important ones. While there are other electrolytes you also want to be getting in your diet, those are the ones we're going to focus on for this video. So magnesium and potassium you can get from leafy greens, dark chocolate, pumpkin seeds, nuts. What
Even
else?
Avocados.
Avocados. So all great sources, but some people find that they can't get it all from their diet, in which case you could do something as simple as a multivitamin.
So while many people can get most of their electrolytes from their diet, other people find that they still have a difficult time. There are different ways to go about making sure that you get what you need out of your diet, and that may include a tablet supplement, or it may include using a powder, such as the Ultima powder, which you can find in CVS, online, or other sources. We personally like that powder because it doesn't have any added sugars or sweeteners or anything artificial in it that's gonna spike your glucose, and you're getting the electrolytes you know that you need. However, if you think you're really deficient in an electrolyte, you should be working with your healthcare provider to make sure it's supplemented correctly. You can overdo potassium when it's taken orally, although magnesium will usually find its way out quickly.
So again, there's Ultima, which is a powdered drink flavor that also has electrolytes in it. Mm-hmm. You can find it at Whole Foods, Amazon, CVS, bunch of places, even Target sometimes. There are other ones as well. That's just the one that we've found. And
the most helpful.
Exactly. And we like the flavor too.
And again, try to get your micronutrients such as your electrolytes from your diet first and only supplement if you think you're still low.
Generally, people will know if they're low because they have symptoms such as fatigue, nausea, muscle cramps. Muscle cramps is a big one for people.
Also known as the keto flu.
But you can get those keto flu symptoms even when you've been keto for quite some time. And that's because you are deficient in those electrolytes.
So make sure you're supplementing those electrolytes if need be, but try to get them primarily from your diet and work up from there. Step 4, be patient and be kind.
The weight didn't come on overnight and it's not gonna go away overnight. It takes 3 to 7 days just to get into ketosis, and you don't want to quit before you even had a chance to get into ketosis and start noticing those benefits.
So give yourself 30 days. You can do anything for 30 days. I remember when I first started on this diet, I was thinking, man, I can't wait till I can get back to eating those delicious carb-ridden foods. But then the longer I went, the more I realized I really didn't want to get back to that. Because after I hit 30 days, I was feeling great. I had lost some weight. My body had started to adapt, and I was feeling like this was the right diet for me.
Plus, those foods are always going to be there. It's not like you don't know what they taste like, and it's not like they're going to go away. You know what all those foods taste like, and they'll be there in 30 days if you decide you want them.
Finally, you need to be kind to yourself.
We are our own worst critics. We can easily look in a mirror and find 20 things we hate about ourselves in under 5 seconds. But ask yourself to name 3 things that you love about yourself, and it's going to take substantially longer. We need to be our biggest cheerleaders. We need to be talking ourselves up every day. Instead of pointing out all of our flaws, we need to say, you look great today. You've done so well. You're super motivated today. I love that you're looking to make a change. Let's do this. Seriously, hype yourself up, because that's going to be what keeps you going. If you're constantly tearing yourself down, you're gonna find your motivation starts to wane a little bit.
One way that we both had success with this was by setting small goals. So I didn't say, I'm gonna lose 50 pounds in 5 months. I did pretty close to that, but I didn't set that as my main goal. My main goal was, I have this main target I wanna reach, but I wanna start by retraining myself in how I think about food, and then maybe start eating an appropriate amount of calories. Brought my calories down, fit it all within the spectrum of a ketogenic diet. And then I kept working on goals to achieve each step of the way. I set new targets for weight loss. I set new targets for size of clothes that I wanted to fit in. I set new targets for certain areas where I felt like I could still see unwanted body fat, like the chin. It's always been a struggle point for me. And I eventually would see myself meet these targets, and it was just another pick-me-up that day. Wow, today I wake up, I feel less bloated. I feel like I have more energy. This is great. This is the right lifestyle for me.
It's important to make non-scale goals as well. It can't always just be focused on that number. So it could be maybe your first week tracking every day. Then the next week, staying within your macros every day that you track. And just progressively work on making a small change each day that adds up to a big change. And we don't have to strive for perfection, but we do want to strive for progress.
Progress can mean different things for different people, but make sure you set realistic goals that you can keep achieving along your journey on the ketogenic diet.
Go ahead and start today. You don't need a new month, a new year. You don't need to wait for Monday. You can start right now. Get in the frame of mind that you want to make a lifestyle change, plan out your day, and just start. And that's our 4 easy steps to getting started on the ketogenic diet.
We hope you found it informative and helpful.
And we also hope that you hit the like button down below if you enjoyed the video and you subscribe to our channel.
Share this video if you think it would be helpful for others, and join us for our next video on the ketogenic diet.
Make sure to comment down below of things that you'd want us to talk about in the future.